it's an odd sort of mix for me just because we're doing this first. So what you're going to hear this morning is not even close to the kind of style or anything you'll hear tomorrow morning because I'm treating this like a masterclass. The reason I'm treating it like a masterclass is because you got up and came to church on Saturday morning, all right? Which that tells me a couple things. One, you're in some sort of dynamic working relationship with Jesus. And you're waking up in general saying yes to the infinite possibilities God has for your life. And you came to learn something about the Bible. And that's what I'm good at, all right? So my goal today, anytime we speak, we want three things to happen. We want Jesus to get bigger. We want the cross to work better. We want the resurrection to be central. So Jesus is bigger, cross works better, resurrection is central. And for this morning, I want to make the scriptures bigger, not smaller. I want to make the scriptures more beautiful, not less beautiful. And to do that, I want to teach you a bit about the Bible. All right, I want to talk about the Bible in general. Because how you come across to your community oftentimes is directly a reflection of how you think about scripture. If you think about scripture one way, you'll come across that one way, and I think we've all had that experience where somebody said something about the Bible that even though they what they said was technically right, you sort of threw up a little bit in your mouth, and you're sort of like, what is that? You don't ever want to come across in that way. So what we're going to do is we're going to work from the general to the specific. So we're going to talk about general things to the specific, right? Because here's what I think that you wouldn't be in church on a Saturday morning if you wanted to destroy the Bible, right? The problem is that the Bible is going to face incredible challenges, and it is our fault, okay? It is nobody else's fault, and the reason is because we're the gatekeepers to how we speak about Scripture, right? And the problem is that there's certain things you can't say about Scripture anymore, primarily because of Google. If you say certain things about Scripture, a 15-year-old can check that in 10 seconds. Whereas it used to have taken my father 3 weeks to get to the Library of Congress to check the same information that you can shall check on the palm of your hand, which remains sort of an issue. Now, it's something that I think we want to do. And if you want to ruin the Bible, let me give you a couple ways to do it. Right? Here's how you ruin it. If you want to ruin the Bible, here's exactly how you do it. Speak of the Bible in static terms, all right? So let me tell you what I mean by that. So God wrote it, we believe it, that settles it. Well, that's just dumb. Everything in the Bible God put there, also dumb. These things don't work. People say, oh, we got to get back to the Bible. Which part? Which part? The part in Exodus 21 that says it's okay to beat a slave for laziness so long as he doesn't die within a day of the beating. If it takes him more than a day to die, that's okay. But if it takes him less than a day to die, that's murder. That one? Or maybe we'll get back to the Bible. Or about the one in Deuteronomy 21 that says it's okay to kidnap foreign teenage girls, shave their heads, clip their nails, and force them to marry foreign warriors. That one. Or how about the one that says the way to handle rebellious sons is to stone them? That one. Or how about the one that says you can stone an adulterer? That one. Or how about Ecclesiastes where it says there's no such thing as heaven or hell. When you die, you just go back to dirt like a dog. That one. Or how about the one in Corinthians that says women should shut their flipping mouths in church? We didn't get back to the Bible. See, you can't treat the Bible in static terms. If you treat the Bible in static terms, you will ruin the Bible. And I love the Bible, so please don't ruin the Bible. I've given my life to studying it. I've given my life to communicating it. And I hate it when people who are trying to defend the Bible ruin the Bible. The Bible is not a static record of what God is. The Bible is, in fact, a dynamic, progressive revelation of what people thought God was at the time it was written. And it was such a dynamic leap forward to the final revelation of God, the risen Christ, that God gave life by breathing on it, and that is called inspiration. That is what the Bible is. And that's what you see in the Bible. I'll on my little makeshift whiteboard here. What you see in the Bible is that as time moved forward, people's understanding got better. Does it stand to reason that Noah's understanding of what God was far more primitive than Abraham's? And Abraham's understanding was far more primitive than Moses's. And Moses' understanding of God was a good leap forward from what Abraham understood God to be. And then the prophets had a big old giant leap forward as well. And then, of course, this all culminates in the risen Christ. The Bible is the Word of God, but it is not the final Word of God. The final Word of God is the risen Christ.
Right.
And so what you want to do with the Bible is you've got to read the historical arc into it. You have to ask, what is this revealing about what they thought about God at the time, and how does this move the world forward to the risen Christ? That is why it is in there. If you take something in and of itself, it can ruin things. It can absolutely decimate things. Maybe you take something big, like, what does God require for us to be okay with Him? You know, in Abraham's day, you know what you had to do to be okay with God? You had to kill your kid. That's what all Sumerian culture thought. To make it rain so they didn't die from starvation, you had to kill your child. So Abraham, what does he do? He goes up a mountain to kill his child. Why? Because that's what you did in those days. And Abraham's the first person ever in the history of the world to get the revelation that you don't have to kill your kid anymore, we can kill animals instead. Now, is that a word from God? Oh, yeah. Is that inspired? You bet. Is that the final word of God? No chance. But it's a great part of the story. It's leading us somewhere. Before Abraham, they were killing kids to make it rain. After Abraham, they started killing animals to get forgiveness. That's a really good flippant move. Is that the last move? No. Is it a good move? Yes. Later, Moses says, let's not kill a lot of animals. Let's kill one animal per family per year. Let's do that. Is that a good move? Yes. Is that the Word of God? Yes. Is that different than the Word of God God gave Abraham? Yes. Is it better? Yes. God is moving things forward. And then, of course, later, a prophet named Micah said, don't worry about sacrificing at all. Just do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with God, you'll be okay. That's a pretty good move forward. But if anybody got stuck and saw Moses' revelation about God as static, then they would ruin Micah's revelation. Micah was taking this somewhere else, and then Jesus comes along and makes God the nicest person ever. And he's like, you know, you've heard it said one sacrifice per family per year. Let's do something better than that. Let's do one sacrifice for the whole world for all time. But see, but if you remove the risen Christ as the final word of God, if you remove the risen Christ as the climax to the story, then the Bible actually gets ugly. I mean, there's just stuff in there that's just, in and of itself, by itself, is ugly stuff. But when you see it as a part of a historical arc, you can read it better. Let me sort of put some language around this. Our goals today is to have fun. I think it's a sin to be boring. If we get boring, we'll just go eat, because there's no reason to do that. I didn't get up at 3 a.m. in Portland, Oregon and fly here to be here for now to be boring. We're going to have some fun. We're going to engage Scripture. We're going to do that a lot, actually. We're going to ask questions. My goal today is to create more questions than answers. And that's good. And here's why. If I create more questions than answers, and you're forced to have to go speak to your three or four best friends about what we talk about today, and you're talking about God instead of the Phoenix Suns, then it's a good thing. Right?
Amen.
And we want to initiate conversation. We don't want to close conversation. We want to initiate it. Here's the problem with the Bible. It's complex. You see lots of different dimensions in it. Not only do you have to answer the question, how would that have been taken at the time it was written? What did they mean there? What is that revealing about what they thought there? And how is what they thought there different than what ultimately the risen Christ revealed about God? Not only do you have all of that, you've got multi-layered sort of things. You've got language issues. You've got all of this stuff. Let me give you examples of what I'm talking about here. In the Bible, you find God speaking. Sometimes God's actually talking. He's revealing something. He's moving the world forward. Beautiful stuff. You tell a group of slaves to take a day off, that's beautiful. They never had a day off in their whole life. He says, in our new world, you're going to take a day off. That's going to be awesome. No slave was standing at the base of that mountain going, oh man, he's putting this under the law. No one was doing that. Why? They hadn't had a day off for 430 years. Which means none of them had ever had a day off. So sometimes God is speaking. It's beautiful. It's moving forward. Sometimes you see people thinking God is speaking when he isn't. There are stories in the Bible where someone thought they were hearing from God, and they were not. Here's a great example. In the book of Kings, it says, God told David to take the census. In the book of Chronicles, it says, Satan told David to take a census. And it's talking about the same census. Which, by the way, that means you can never ever tell your kids that the Bible doesn't contradict itself. It does. And it should. Why? Because the Bible's not written by one dude sitting under a tree. The Bible's written by a whole lot of people over a whole lot of periods of time. And it's okay for them to have different opinions about things. The Bible has different opinions about lots of things. I'll give you an example. Is the Bible for or against marriage? The answer is both. Solomon thought it was a really good idea. You find a wife, you find a good thing. He found 1,000 of them. Right? Paul had a completely different opinion on marriage. Paul's opinion on marriage was, he who marries does not sin, but he signed up for a life of pain. That's not contradictory. Find a wife, not a good thing. Paul says, no, wife's a bad thing. It's not a good thing. If you could at all do without it, please do without it. That's Paul's opinion. So which one's God's opinion? Is you find a wife, not a good thing, or don't do it? It's a life of pain. Which one did God say? Then, of course, Jesus had a totally different opinion on marriage. How much did Jesus ever say about marriage? Nothing. As far as I know, he only said one thing about marriage. He was asked, if a man has 7 wives, when he's in heaven, who will be his wife? And Jesus' response was, I'm quoting now, don't worry about marriage, it's not in heaven anyway. That's it. Jesus' whole advice on marriage was don't worry about it. So why do we worry about it so much? Now, if you hear that and you go, Shane, surely there's something going on there. Tell us, I'd love to see my schnookums in heaven. If that's your thought, then you probably have a good marriage. But if I quote Jesus like that, which is a direct quote from Jesus, and deep inside your heart secretly you go, yes, for a start. I have some stuff to work on. I'm simply pointing out you can't try to make the Bible behave in static black and white terms. It just doesn't. Why? Because it's written by a whole lot of people. And a whole lot of people can have a whole lot of different opinions about things. And a whole lot of people can have... God told David to take a census. It's in Kings. Chronicles says Satan told David to take a census. So which one was it? Was it God? Was it Satan? Is that the one time ever that God and Satan agreed on something? If you tell your children the Bible doesn't contradict itself, here's how easy that is. They Google Bible contradictions. And by the way, if you Google Bible contradictions, that's number 3. God told David to take a census. Satan told David to take a census. So how do you deal with that? What do? If the Bible's some sort of static record of what God is, like God was in heaven whispering, and then someone's writing it down, that makes no sense. You can't do that. The answer's actually fairly easy. You've got to consider historical art. The book of Kings was written in first person. There was a chronicler following David around, writing down everything he was doing. That was common practice in those days. David says, we're going to take a census because God told me to. Now, did David think God told him to? Yeah. Did the chronicler write it down right? Yeah, it's fine. God told David to take a census. No worries. That's the book of Kings. The book of Chronicles was written 300 years later with the help of hindsight, knowing that that census led them into years of slavery. So when the writer of Chronicles is rewriting Jewish history for the newest generation so that they would know where they came from, he can't say the census was God's idea. That would be insane. What was happening is what happened in that story is David thought God told him to take the census, but in hindsight, turned out he wasn't hearing from God at all. Has that ever happened to you? These people were real people who lived in a real place at a real time. Sometimes that's why we see God speaking. Sometimes you see people legitimately thinking God's telling them to do something, and they think he wasn't, and then it gets recorded. But you can't see it as static. 3, you see people curse when God is blessing. That happens in the Bible. A great example of that is in Genesis chapter 9, In Genesis chapter 9, verse 1, Genesis chapter 9, verse 7, Genesis chapter 9, verse 17, it says this: God blessed all of Noah's sons. Well, that's all of them. Shem, Ham, Jacob. God blessed all of Noah's sons. And then what happened? Noah got so drunk, he didn't remember getting naked. Now that's drunk right there. I don't care who you are. That is like there's levels to drunk. There's like relaxed and then slightly buzzed, and then there's drunk, and then there's something called off your face, and then past that is I don't remember getting naked, right? And he wakes up. Now, if you've ever been so drunk you don't remember getting naked, what is the next morning like? It's pretty bad. It's pretty bad. It's called a hangover, right? And remember, Noah lived in a day far worse than today. There was no pain meds. There's no Advil. There's no aspirin. He just had to find the closest ginger root and gnaw on it until he felt better, you know? It's just a bad day. And in his drunken, angry, hungover stupor, he chooses to curse his son. Here's the problem. Did God curse him or did Noah curse him? God blessed him. Noah, in a drunken, angry, hungover stupor, chose to curse someone God was blessing. And if you know the end of the story, that curse stuck around for a very, very long time. Who was Ham's firstborn son? Canaan. Who was Canaan's firstborn son? Sidon. Who were the cursed people? The Sidonites. So when Jesus later says, there were lots of widows in Israel, but God chose to feed the widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. They want to throw him off the cliff in the intimation that God blessed the Sidonites. Why? Because it stuck around. You know how long it stuck around? It stuck around to the 1950s. Southern American pastors rationalized the mistreatment of black people by using that verse. Here was their logic. God cursed Ham. Ham historically ended up in Ethiopia. Black people are in Ethiopia, therefore all black people were cursed. That was the logic. You know what that's called? That's called Homer Simpson logic. Right? But they used the Bible to rationalize horrendous behavior. I mean, horrendous thought. Sometimes you see people cursing when God is in that blessing. Sometimes you see people act with heroic obedience. Lots of stories like that. Heroic obedience. Like you can't believe it. David and Goliath and all this stuff. But you also see people act with heartbreaking disobedience. And so the question is, why would the bad stuff be in the Bible? Because it's part of the story. If you remove the negative stuff, it doesn't give the beautiful stuff as much beauty. For instance, if you remove a time where they thought they had to kill animals to please God, if you remove that time from the risen Christ, from the backdrop of the risen Christ has less meaning without the backdrop of that story. And so your story, I'll say it this way, it's true of your life. Everything belongs in your story. You know those ugly junior high pictures that you hope nobody ever sees because your braces and the haircut you thought was cool? Remember that? But it's part of your story. The issue with the Bible is everything belongs. Everything. Everything belongs in the story. The good, the bad, the ugly. They didn't leave anything out. If it happened, they just put it on in there. No matter how embarrassing it might have been. There's crazy stuff in there. You read past the surface. There's stuff in there that's like, what's going on here? You got Moabite women waiting till the middle of the night when a rich Israelite is drunk and crawling under the covers with him and uncovering his feet. Oh, oh, oh. That's sort of seedy sort of stuff. You realize that's not his feet, right? And it's a euphemism. The Hebrew euphemism, there's a Hebrew metaphor for genitals. Feet. You see it in Song of Solomon. When the man comes back from a long trip and he wants to get busy, as men do, and he says, essentially, okay. And remember what she says? She says, oh, my feet are already clean. Must I dirty them again? Right? Obviously a metaphor for that was now once again, like all metaphors, sometimes feet mean feet. Right? So when it says, how lovely are the feet of him who brings good news, right? It's obviously talking about feet. Or a foot washing is an actual Middle Eastern custom of washing actual feet. They weren't. So some of this makes common sense. Yeah. So sometimes there's stuff in there, it's like, wow, how did that make it in the Bible? Right? But if you see the Bible as static, like it's all God's will, no, it's all part of the story. That encapsulates the risen Christ with more beauty. This happens to me all the time now. I was put in a room with 500 university students. And the guy in charge said, "You guys know all those hard questions you ask me about the Bible? Ask him." And all of them got their phones out and started Googling horrible Bible passages, Bible errors, Bible contradictions. And they'd come up at microphones on either side, and they'd go, "This is a good one, this is a good one," right? And then they would ask me about these things, right? And like one of the ones that came up was, "Why is God for bashing infants' heads against stones?" And I said, she said, Psalm 137, "The Lord our God will delight to bash your children's heads against stones." Direct quote. "The Lord our God will delight to bash your children's heads against stones." Why is God okay with that? Once again, you treat the Bible that way, you ruin the Bible. Is God okay with bashing children's heads against stones? No. I think not. So what's going on there? Who wrote Psalm 137? Trick question, we don't know. It's an anonymous one. What we do know is what happened to him. We know that whoever wrote Psalm 137 was a Babylonian captive. He was taken by Nebuchadnezzar into captivity in Babylon. Do you know what Nebuchadnezzar did to captives? If you were under the age of 8, he would have his soldiers take you by your feet and bash your head against the closest stone, like a whip. If you were over the age of 30, you were killed because you were too old. If you were over the age of 8 and under the age of 30, and you were a woman, you were instantly a sex slave. If you were over the age of 8 and under the age of 30 and you were a man, he wanted you for your muscle to be a slave, but he didn't want you to be able to procreate, so he would hold you down, and they would hold you down, they would take two stones, and they would crush your testicles. That's the guy that wrote Psalm 137. He's had a bad day. His wife has likely been raped to death. His children's heads have been bashed against stones. He's lost his testicles. What do you do when you lose your testicles, your wife, your children, your land, your job, all one day? What do? You write a poem. And what's in that poem? What's in that poem is a heartfelt desire for God to get them back. Psalm 137 is not a static record of what God is. Psalm 137 is a record, an authentic record, of what that guy hoped God would be. And wouldn't you? If that happened to you, wouldn't you say, "May the Lord our God delight in bashing your head, kids, and so?" But if you just see it as some sort of static record of what God is, you're right. You know who does that? There's people who post things on Google who will tell your children that God is for that, and they risk losing their faith in Jesus because of how we speak about the Bible. May that never be. Because we can fix that. But you see tragic atrocities included in the story. Sodom. It's not like God was for anything going on in Sodom. Yeah, Jephthah killing his daughter because of a rash vow. Why would you include that? It's part of the story. It's part of the story. They didn't pick and choose. This is part of the story. This is what happened. It's unfortunate. It wasn't necessary. This is what happened. You sometimes see God's behavior play. Sometimes. Sometimes you see things going both ways. People say, "Oh, Shane, the Bible doesn't contradict itself." I beg your pardon, it sure does. Contradicts itself on marriage, for sure. And then, what about this? Proverbs 26, verse 4. Proverbs 26, verse 4. The word of the Lord says, "When a fool addresses you, don't even answer back, lest you lower yourself to his intelligence." Proverbs 26, verse 5. Next verse. "When a fool addresses you, answer him bluntly to reveal his folly." Well, what am I meant to do? Sometimes you see that. Sometimes you see descriptions of events that God was happy about, things that please the Lord. Mostly when marginalized people get help, things like this. Sometimes you just see descriptions of events that just happen. You see descriptions of things that just happen. When we get to the specific, I'm gonna tell you the story of why Ruth the story of Ruth, when it happened, was actually heresy. It became part of the scripture later, but when it happened, it was actually heresy. It was directly forbidden in the book of Deuteronomy. We'll talk about that. Like, there's stuff that just happened. Sometimes you see parables and fictional stories to make a moral life point or explain the meaning of a life event. Like one of the big concerns you use is, is the Bible literal? Well, what do you mean by that? Like, literal really isn't the right word, by the way. Literal is a descriptive word about how words refer to other things. So literal and metaphor are how words refer to other things. What you're actually looking for is concrete or abstract, right? So you can refer to something concrete in a metaphorical way. Like, if you refer to your car as the old tin can. It's a concrete thing that you're referring to metaphorically. Or you can refer to the car as in literal terms. But to say, is the Bible literal? Well, it depends on what you're talking about. Like, was it a parable? Was it a fictional story? Was it a poem? What are we talking about here? Somebody says, Shane, the Bible's literal. I don't care which, the Bible's literal, and I literally keep it. Good. Here's the thing, right? So Jesus said, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out of your head. Good luck being literal. And you don't even see the most ardent followers of Jesus obeying him. You never, 12 men, 3 years, you mean there wasn't one lust, please? And there was not one time in the Gospels where one of his 12 went, oh, God, I'm so sorry. I couldn't stop looking. I promise, I only got one more go at this. No, you just go. Obviously a metaphor. It's okay for some of it to be a parable or a fictional story. Here's the problem. Here's why it gets complicated, okay? Before 1400 AD, in all literature, there was no such thing as nonfiction or fiction. It was perfectly appropriate to put a fiction story in the middle of a nonfiction story as long as the fictional story exacerbated the meaning of the nonfiction story. So, I'll give you a great example. Did Jonah actually get swallowed by a real fish? Does Jonah have to actually be swallowed in order for the book of Jonah to be true? And if you think that's true, then you've missed the point of the entire point of the book of Jonah. That it is Jonah historical narrative. Some of it. Obvious. There was a guy in the lineage named Jonah who was the son of Amittai. That's real. That's obviously historical narrative. He was called to Nineveh, not Narnia. Okay? Nineveh was an actual place. So you got all this stuff that's obviously historical narrative, but then right in the middle of the historical narrative, you got this weird story about a fish. And then there's this weird sort of account that while in the belly of the fish, he prays 10 perfect prayers from the book of Psalms. No mention of the obscenities coming out of his mouth all the way down. And then at the end of the story, there's this odd story about a plant that grows up like 8 foot tall and then dies within a day. Well, is that literal? And the truth is, maybe. But the other truth of it is that it was perfectly appropriate in those days to put a parable in the middle of historical narrative to exacerbate the meaning of the historical narrative. So, if you go, you know what? If you don't believe Jonah actually got swallowed, then you don't have faith in Jesus. That's the kind of bullcrap that doesn't fly. You can't do that. And you've missed the point. And also, if you go, you know what? If you believe a person actually got swallowed, you're an idiot. I don't want to listen to you at all. You also have missed the point. The point of the fish is how far God will go to rescue your sorry behind when you are running and doing the exact opposite thing of what you're supposed to be doing. That's the point. Whether it actually happened or whether it's a parable doesn't mean it's not true. I mean, if you spend your life trying to study zoology to find the one plant that can grow up 8 foot tall and then die, you've missed the point. The point of that story was God was showing Jonah to care about people more than plants, to care about permanent things far more than things that go away. That's the point. Might it have actually happened? Yes. Might it be a parable in the middle of a historical narrative? Yes, but it's not worth fighting over. It's not worth ruining people's faith over. And it sure ain't worth having risked people might miss Jesus over the way we speak about this stuff. If the Bible ever becomes a hurdle to people finding Jesus, my Lord, we've missed the point. It's amazing that the purposes of Jesus somehow went forward before there was a Bible. You realize there was no Bible till 350 AD? And then what was missing? Printing press. So how many copies of it were there? Not very many. 1400, they made a printing press. Now you can print it. And then what was missing? Literacy. World literacy didn't jump over 50% until 1800. So somehow, for the first 1800 years of church history, the purposes of the risen Christ went forward before everybody could cast their opinion on Google about what the Bible could actually say. Somehow the risen Christ won. So we've got to think about what we think about these things. There's references to tribal literature. Like and that should be obvious. The Bible is written in an ancient world. The writers of the Bible reference things. Jesus referenced people. Now it's not in the endnotes, but roughly a third of everything Jesus said was taught by a guy named Hillel 30 years before Jesus. They know that because they have the writings of Hillel. And the writings of Hillel died when Jesus was 18 years old. So the stuff Jesus was saying was subsequent to Hillel. Does that cheapen Jesus? No. It just means Jesus was studied and he learned and he got mentored by these guys just like we would be. There's all kinds of references to other tribal literature. Genesis is a great example of that. The first 11 chapters of Genesis is actually all in the Babylonian scriptures, the Enumerates, the Epic of Atrahasis, and the Epic of Gilgamesh. All the entire thing, all first 11 chapters of Genesis, actually was written 1,300 years before Moses. Moses is recapturing that story. And what's he doing with that story? Genesis, listen, if you never listen to one other thing I say, listen to me right now. Genesis 1 is not a science book. To speak it as such ruins it. You'll destroy it. It's not a science book. The reason is it wasn't intended to be a science book. In 1847, archaeologists uncovered the library of Nineveh. The library of a man named Tiglath-Pileser. And can you imagine that this was before, like, this is scrolls and tablets. And they had to handle it with such care, but years of going through and being careful. When they got done processing all of those works, they found the vault. When they got in the vault, they found three fully intact copies of the Enumerates, the Epic of Atrahasis, and the Epic of Gilgamesh. Those were the Sumerian scriptures. Think of it as Old Testament, New Testament, Book of Mormon, right? Just three of them. And think about your Bible. Who was from ancient Sumeria? Abraham. So who would have grown up with those stories? Abraham. Abraham would have passed those stories along. Isaac, Jacob. And then, of course, by the time Moses gets hold of it, he's simply retelling the stories in a way that's tribal poetry to exalt the Israelite God over the Babylonian gods. It's a one-upsmanship sort of fight. The creation story is in the Enumerates. The Noah story is in all three. The Enumerates, the Epic of Atrahasis, and the Epic of Gilgamesh. The Tower of Babel is in all three. These are references to tribal literature. Are you guys bored? No, but okay. Give you a concrete example of what I'm talking about. Here is the creation story as told in the Enumerates. Ready? Tell me if this sounds familiar. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And he did so by having a big struggle with watery chaos. Of course, the watery chaos was given a name. It was his great-grandmother, the goddess of watery chaos. Her name was Tiamat. And he was fighting the watery chaos. And because she was made of water, he couldn't beat her. Like, you know, you take a sword and you slash water, it just sort of goes out. So here's what he does. He sneaks up behind her one day, and he divides her in half with a divider, and he locked half of the watery chaos in the heavens above, and the other half of the watery chaos in the earth below. And now that half of the watery chaos was locked in the heavens above and the other half in the earth below, he was able to bring order out of the chaos because he was only fighting half. So first, he fought the half of the watery chaos in the heavens above, and he brought the firmament, the sun, moon, stars, and all of this stuff, right? And then he fought the watery chaos in the earth below, and he brought land, sea, vegetation, sea life, and then ultimately man. And this took him millions of years to do that. Does that sound familiar? Moses gets a hold of that, and he goes, "In the beginning, Elohim," not Marduk. Marduk was the Babylonian god. "In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And he did so by dividing the watery chaos into the heavens above and the earth below. But when he faced the watery chaos, what did he do? He hovered over the water." The word "hover" in Hebrew means to relax. Essentially, Moses is saying, "You Babylonians, your concept of God is so small. It took your God millions of years to defeat the watery chaos. Our God faced the same watery chaos, and he relaxed. And not only did he not fight, he just spoke and it obeyed. It took your God millions of years to do this. Our God did it in 6 days and had a day left over to chill." Our God's better. Genesis 1 is tribal poetry exalting the Israelite God over the Babylonian high god Marduk. It's also a temple story. It's a story where God creates a dwelling place that he's going to choose to dwell. And what do you do when you make a temple? You intricately decorate it with all kinds of different things. And then what is the last thing you do when you make a temple? The last thing you do when you make a temple is you put an image of that God in the middle of the temple and give it authority over it. To take something that beautiful and that dynamic and that inspiring and that life-giving, to take something like that and dumb it down to, well, what's the science in that? He wasn't writing a science book. He was writing tribal poetry. So we have to make sure that we're not doing genre confusion. I give you an example. If you Google Bible errors, I know because I was in a room with 500 people doing it. If you Google Bible errors, Psalm 104 says this: "The Lord our God, he is the great creator. He put the earth in its place, and now the earth never moves." Is that true? Don't think too hard about that. Is that true? No. The earth is moving in every conceivable way. It's spinning. It's doing that. It's moving around. Now think about your history, right? What major character in history got really hurt by that scripture? Galileo. So Galileo, 1633, said to the church, "Guys, the earth's moving." "Hey guys, the earth's moving." Do you know what the church said? "That's impossible. The Bible says it doesn't." He said, "Listen, you guys are going to have to reinterpret that. I'm not against you. I'm trying to save you some embarrassment here. The earth is moving." And this is what they said: "Galileo, if science and scripture don't add up, scripture always wins." Well, that's dangerous. Unless you're going to make a case that the writer of Psalm 104 is writing a science book. Right? Do you know what they did to Galileo? They said, "Galileo, you're going to recant this or you're going to hell." He said, "Whatever, bro. I'm just telling you, the earth is moving." So they put Galileo in hell, 1633. You know when they let him out? 1992, the head of the church said, "You know what, we were wrong about that. It takes a long time for the church to find out." Turns out the earth is moving. It kind of helped when we put a man on the moon and he looked back at it. That kind of, you know, sort of helped. And, you know what, we're going to let Galileo out of hell, which in and of itself is quite common. We're going to, like, "Excuse me, can we have Galileo that?" You know? Galileo comes up out of hell all jacked up. Man, I'm glad y'all figured that out. It's a hot as hell down there. Genre confusion. Was the writer of Psalm 104 writing a science book? No, he was writing a poem of praise about his awe of a creator despite his lack of understanding of how physical realities worked. And that's inspiring. That's moving. But you can't treat it as some sort of static thing. You have authentic expressions of where people were at the time it was written. You have authentic expressions of where people were. Did Moses legitimately think you had to kill animals to please God? Yeah. Was he right about that? No. The writer of Hebrews says, didn't you know all along it was impossible for the blood of animals to take away your sin? Of course, every Jew reading that thought, that would have been useful information yesterday. We could have had more to eat. But it was a good part of the story. It was a giant leap ahead of killing a whole lot of animals, which was a giant leap ahead of killing kids. It was a part of the story. And it's authentic. It's authentic. In Ecclesiastes, when the writer of Ecclesiastes, when he says, there's no such thing as heaven or hell, when you die, you go back to dirt. Is that true? No. It's in the Bible. So can the Bible say something in our church? What's going on there? Well, it's a part of Colette. The writer of Ecclesiastes was a man named Colette. And it's a part of Colette's diary. There was a time in his life where he felt that was true. But if you read all the way to the end of Ecclesiastes, he comes to a completely different conclusion. But you just can't take that one part, though, see? So you gotta make sure that you're reading the whole story. You also have people's observations. If people's observations. Like, there's a verse in the Bible that says Jesus was full of Beelzebub. Is that true? No. Is it true that they thought that was true? Yes. The people use it. There's a verse in there that says Jesus wasn't educated. Is that true? No. The same people who said he was full of Beelzebub and out of his mind and a drunkard also said he wasn't educated. Why do we... Well, we would never take the first three, but oh, he's not been educated. How do I know he was educated? Because he was a rabbi. How do I know he's a rabbi? Because they called him rabbi. And he had a regular speaking spot in the temple. And people who ran the temple hated him, but they couldn't stop him from speaking. Why? Because he had... They didn't just let any redneck read the Torah. You kidding me right now? How many other people in the Bible are called rabbi? One, Paul, because he was a rabbi. But you never see him go Rabbi D or Rabbi J. No, but that was special. That was special. You see, you have a lot in the Bible that is simply someone's opinion. And it's part of the story. You have different opinions for different authors. We've already talked about that. Lots of examples of that. Do you answer a fool? Do you not answer a fool? Is marriage good? Is it not a good idea? Or should we just not worry about it? Different opinions, different authors. One Bible. It's beautiful. It's beautiful when you see it for what it is. When you interpret how it's intended to be read. But when you make the Bible behave in a way that the writers of the Bible never intended for it to behave, even if our heart is to defend and honor the Scripture, we're actually destroying it. Actually destroying it. Now, a quick word about inspiration. Because the thought would be, wait a minute now, Shane, I'm under your faith in Jesus, and I want to speak with respect, and of course no one would be antagonistic in here. But doesn't the Scripture say that it's inspired? Yes, it does in one place. So let's talk about what that means. The word inspiration comes from the Latin root spire. Now, the Latin root spire means to breathe. So respiration is to breathe over and over. That's respiration, spire, right? To aspirate means you can't breathe, right? So something gets like, he's aspirating code, right? Is that, right? Right? So to inspire, what does inspire mean? Does inspire mean you're sitting up somewhere and you're whispering in someone's ear? No. Inspire means somebody wrote something and God breathed on it. So to inspire means to breathe, put breath into something. To expire means to take breath out of something. So in the ancient world, they never said people died. They said they expired. Literally, a very primitive way of saying, hey, Bill, did you see that? He breathed out and then breathed in again. He lost his breath. That was death. To expire. To inspire means to breathe into something. Which leads to this question. What is the first thing in the Scriptures God breathed on? That's not hard. What is the first thing in the Scripture? Yeah, it was not, well, sort of. First thing he breathed on was dirt. And when God breathed on dirt, what happened?
Grass grew.
Man. So what are you? You're breathed on dirt. You are what happens when God's breath inspires dirt. You're inspired dirt. And as long as you're breathing, what are you? Inspired dirt. You quit breathing, what happens? You turn back into normal dirt. But while you are inspired, you are inspired dirt. When you quit breathing, you now normal dirt. So if you're inspired dirt, what are you? You're holy dirt. And if you're holy dirt, what are you? You're holy ground. Sometimes we're looking for the next piece of holy ground, but we're looking too far because you are the holy ground.
Come on.
Is the Bible inspired? Oh, yeah. Are you inspired? Oh, yeah. One writer later said it this way, let your life be the epistle for all to read. Paul, living in a day where he never thought there'd ever be a day that we'd have Bibles on our phones. He writes, listen, we don't have Bibles everywhere. Matter of fact, Bible hasn't been invented yet. Your life. This world doesn't need more Bibles. This world needs Christians living inspired.
Come on, man.
That's inspired. So does inspired necessarily mean perfect? No. Are you perfect? No. Are you inspired?
Yes.
When Moses wrote, let's kill animals to be forgiven. Is that inspired? Yes. Is that perfect?
No.
Jesus was perfect. The final word of God is perfect. What you're finding in these inspiring moments is dynamic leaps forward. What we're going to do this morning is, because I've been talking for 55 minutes. I hope it didn't feel like that. Well, that's good. And I don't want to out-talk your butt or your gut, right? So if I out-talk your butt or out-talk your gut, you can get irritated. So here's the thing. This day's supposed to end at noon, right? And we'll come back tonight. I'm going to do some really specific stuff tonight. So we're going to take a break here a second, but I want to leave you with this example. This is Deuteronomy 21. Now, before we read this, is Deuteronomy 21 in the Bible? Yeah. Is it inspired?
Yeah.
Are we all on the same page, right? Right. Does Shane Willard think it's inspired? Yes, I don't want any Facebook posts anymore. Is Deuteronomy 21 inspired? We're all on the same page. We're pretty confident about this, right?
Alright.
The word of the Lord. When you go out to war against your enemies, and the Lord your God delivers them into your hands, and you take captives, if you notice amongst the captives a beautiful woman, and you're attracted to her, you can take her to be your wife. Bring her to your home. Have her shave her head. Trim her nails. Have her put aside the clothes she was wearing when she was captured. After she's lived in your house and mourned her father and mother, who you killed, for a full month, then you may go into her and be her husband. She shall be your wife. Yes, that's what that's talking about. If you're not pleased with her, in other words, if she's not good in bed, let her go wherever she wishes. You just must not sell her or treat her as a slave, since you've dishonored her.
And the whole room leans forward.
want to know what I would say. What do you say? We'll talk about that when we come back. Let's take we're going to take a 10-minute break, okay? Because I do want to get through some stuff in the backside of this. In the break, out there is a huge resource table I forgot to talk about. It's a lot of our teachings. Everything's available in four formats: CD, DVD, USB, and direct download, okay? It's a lot. So in other words, if you don't know what a USB is, just get a CD, all right? So it's meant for that. Now, if you're wondering, why do you carry that around with you? There's a reason for that. The reason is because we make a whole flipping load of money from it, okay? And the reason we do that is because we believe that we're not called to go to heaven when we die. We're called to bring heaven to every place we seek help here on our way to heaven. And so the way I run my ministry is I live and move and fly and eat and all of that off of speaker fees. So, and which is kind of ironic because I don't charge a fee. So I will live this week after my plane ticket, all the fees and all of that, off whatever love offering you guys give me. All right? But 100% of the profit from the table. We have three orphanages in China that take care of mentally handicapped children. Two in Hanyang, one in Changsha. So that's how we feed, clothe, shelter, and educate mentally handicapped children. We also have people tell me these girls out of sex trafficking. We have 161 different people being ministered to in Cape Town. It's actually recognized by the Department of Justice in Cape Town as a viable diversion option. They've actually asked my manager, they're considering the chief of police. Okay, so it's really, really going well. So we also use it to go to countries that cannot afford to bring us in, all right? So, because I don't want to say no to a place because they can't afford the plane. That is ridiculous. And I think those of us that live in the richest nation on the earth have the responsibility to help carry those things around. So if you like what you hear over the course of the weekend and you think, man, I'd like to know more, or I just want to help some kids, if you come out there, say hello, let me put something in your hands that'll change the way you look at God forever. You put something in our hands, it helps us feed, clothe, shelter, and educate mentally handicapped children. Okay? With that, let's take a 10-minute break. Shake those heads. Flip those nails. Make little girls marry men they don't love. It's in the Bible. What do you do when a 19-year-old girl says, Shane, why would we ever want to spend eternity with a God who was ever okay with that? You notice what she did with her question? She took my ability to say, well, that was the Old Testament and changed it. But if he was ever okay with it, ever, if God was ever okay with that behavior, why would we want to spend eternity with her? Is she asking a fair question? I say, yes, she is. So I asked her, I said, well, help me with this. What happened? I mean, do girls like you sit around reading Deuteronomy? Or, what happened? She said, no, she said, me and my four friends, we started university, and our philosophy professor saw us wearing, I assume, some bracelet or something that said Jesus or something. And he asked us, he said, can I ask you something? Why would you follow a lunatic? And of course, we fit to Jesus. We were like, Jesus is a lunatic. Yeah. And he said, no, I beg to differ. I think Jesus is a lunatic. And they said, how? And he had a Bible. And he said, this is God's word, right? Yeah. God wrote it, right? She said, yeah. God doesn't change, right? Yeah. And he read it. You realize that you serve a God who was at one time okay with shaving 13-year-old girls' heads and forcing them to be married and then they didn't love? And if he doesn't change, that means he's still okay with it. And you're okay with that, why? I'm just curious. She said, could you please help me? I said, sure, I can. Here's the thing, man. Her faith was on the line. It wasn't just her faith. I'm talking that whole room was like, what would you have said? And it had better be better than,
well, sometimes God's ways aren't our ways.
It'd be better than, well, if it's in there, God has reason. It'd be better than that. It's actually a pretty easy answer to this. The answer is you gotta consider historical arc. You gotta consider where we are in the story. A couple of questions. I wanna empower us to ask the right questions, or a better question than what we normally ask, okay? A couple of questions, and it's okay to be confident. I promise you I'm not trying to trick you, okay? Did God write Deuteronomy? No. Who wrote Deuteronomy? Moses with a team of five other people called DJQB. No. Anyway, so Moses, let's just go with Moses. So Moses writes Deuteronomy. Now, so God didn't write Deuteronomy, Moses did. So, let's ask a second question. Is God for shaving heads, clipping nails, and forcing 13-year-old girls to marry foreign warriors? Is God for that? No. How do you know that? It's in the Bible that he's for it. So how do you know he's not? What, you just get to arbitrarily choose what God's for? Careful how we speak about it. See how we set ourselves up to get decimated. Right? You know that God's not for that because you know the Spirit of the risen Christ and you know Jesus Christ ain't for that. Jesus wasn't for a lot of things that was going on, like stoning adulterers. They tried to get him to one time. He let her off the hook. Right? So, we can say with surety that God didn't write Deuteronomy, Moses wrote it. We can also say with surety that God's not for shaving little girls' heads. Right? Now we got to ask better questions. If God didn't write it and God's not for it, how in the world does it end up in there? And how in the world, the better question is, not is God for it, the question is, why did Moses think God was for it? What Deuteronomy is it is an accurate representation of what Moses thought God was for. And Moses thought God was for that. So the question is not is God for it? That's ridiculous. The question is, why did Moses think he was? And the bigger question is not only why did Moses think he was, but why on earth would God inspire that? And you mean what, you know what I mean by inspire? I mean, like, Moses writes that and God goes, oh yeah, that right there, that's what I'm talking about. Why would he do that? To answer that, I need to talk to the women. No man is allowed to answer me because your opinion doesn't matter on this. In the United States of America, went back to Deuteronomy 21. Would it be a step in the right direction or the wrong direction? Right? Don't think about that too long, right? If the United States of America said, we've heard the will of the evangelical right, and we need to get back to the Bible. Therefore, starting tomorrow, Deuteronomy 21 is now the law of the land. Would America be a better place or a worse place if we went back to that? Far worse. So sometimes getting back to the Bible is the wrong direction. Okay. Yeah. But that's not how you look at it. The reason that's the wrong direction is because we've had years and years and years of knowing more about God and growing and changing and growing consciousness. The question isn't that. The question is, did the world, let me say it this way, did Deuteronomy 21 make the world a better place or a worse place compared to the day before it was written? That's the question. We obviously know that that would make the world a worse place now. But that's not the point. The point is, when Moses wrote it, was Moses saying something that was going to make the world a better place or a worse place for women? And the answer is, quantum leap though. According to the historian Karen Armstrong, she says that this passage right here is the most gigantic leap forward for women's rights ever recorded in the history of the world up to the time of the written. Why? Because in Persian, Greek, and Egyptian law, women were property or people? All property. Every 100% of women were property. Little girls were used as bargaining chips to buy protection from other clans. They were property. Moses, in seeking God, says, God, if you're in charge of Israel, how should we treat women differently? And Moses says, you know, Israelites are going to be different. When we go out to war, if we want to take a woman, we're not going to take her as a slave. We're going to make her our wife. We're going to do that. In other words, if you want to take them, you can't make them a slave. They're not property. You have to make them your wife with the same rights and privileges that the rest of your wives have. You're going to have them shave their head and clip their nails. Now, is that a good thing or a bad thing? It's a good thing. In ancient Jewish mourning, the context was mourning the family. In ancient Jewish mourning, they would shave their heads and clip their nails. Essentially, Moses says, if you're going to take them, you have to let them mourn like a Jew. They're not an outsider. They're not less than. They're not one. They're not somebody else. If you're going to take them, you got to make them your wife with the same rights and privileges that the rest of your wives have. You need to let them mourn like a Jew, be like a Jew. You need to let them come in as an Israelite. And in Israel, we mourn by shaving our heads and clipping our nails. And we normally mourn for 7 days. Because it's their family, you need to give them a full month. It's going over the top. In other words, if you want them, you can have them. Here's what you got to do. You got to let her be your wife with the same rights and privileges that the rest of your wives have. You got to let her mourn like an insider and not an outsider. You got to give her the same standing in your house as your other wives have. And if you find that you don't like her, you can't start buying and selling her, because in Israel, women are people, not property. That's how we're doing things. Now, you realize that that day, the women would have thrown a party for that. That would have been like, can you believe how nice this God is? Israel had the nicest God in the whole world saying stuff like that. Oh, my goodness gracious. It's the men who would have went, really? Come on. It's the men who would have done it. Does that make the world a better or worse place compared to today? Way worse. But compared to the day before it was written, it was a giant leap forward. When you're the first person in the history of the world to say that women are people, not property, is that the word of God? You bet it is. Is that inspired? You bet it is. Is that the final word of God on the subject? Not even close. But it was an awesome part of the story, moving the world to the risen Christ, to where one day a God can say, there is no male or female, slave or free, Greek or Jew. That doesn't happen without that. It's a part of the story. But if you treat that as some sort of static record of what God is, you make it ugly. You ask the leader of ISIS, how are you okay forcing young girls to marry you? You know what he quotes? That. He uses the Bible to enforce his position. You can't see the Bible as a static record of what God is. You've got to see it as a dynamic, progressive revelation of what people thought God was. That was such a giant leap towards the risen Christ that God inspired. He breathed on it and gave it life, because it needed life to get to the risen Christ. That is how beautiful and inspiring and dynamic and moving and earth-shaking the Bible actually is. It's a beautiful thing. If we talk about it like that, we won't lose the next generation. But if you talk about it in static terms, Google will ruin you. They'll drive a Mack truck through your argument. It just doesn't work. There's all kinds of once I gave that answer, I was just waiting. And then the whole room gave a standing ovation. And I didn't care about standing ovation so much. What I cared about was I felt like God used me that day to save that entire room's faith from that kind of thought. And I went back in my room, I was so moved. I was like, moved on the inside. I was invigorated on the inside. And I thought, my God, somebody needs to talk about this more. Somebody needs to give these answers better. Come on! And then I'm thinking, then it hit me, like, well, that was pretty good. So now, I'm in these situations all the time. Once I gave that answer, she said, can I ask you one more? And I thought, oh, no. You're the ask a question person. You know, in the same chapter, this is what it says about how to deal with it if you have a rebellious child. If someone has a stubborn and rebellious son who does not obey his father and mother, will not listen to them when they discipline him. His father and mother should take a hold of him and bring him out to the elders at the gate of his town. He shall say to the elders, the son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He won't obey us. He's a glutton and a drunkard. And all the men of the town are stoned to death.
got to purge evil from amongst you. All miserable here and here. Stone those vulnerable children. Evil, and the evil one amongst you. The Bible tells me so. Okay, so what we do with that? Well, let's practice. Let's see, if we can practice asking the right question, then we can always come to better answers. Did God write Deuteronomy? Who wrote that?
Moses.
So is God for stoning children? I think we can be pretty confident to say that God would be against the practice of stoning children. Okay? So the question isn't, is God for it? Or did God write it? The question is, why did Moses think that was a good idea? And more importantly, why on earth would God breathe life into something so insane? Okay, couple of thoughts on this. Is Moses for stoning children? Well, on the surface it appears so, but I would say no, he's not. Let me back it up. And I want you to look through that passage, and I want you to indicate, see if you can find two words that indicate we're not talking about a child here. Yeah, glutton and drunkard. How many drunkard six-year-olds do you know? Like, if your six-year-old has a drinking problem, I would suggest it's you. Put it higher, right? You know? Imagine some dad dragging some reluctant six-year-old to the town gate, trying to get in my Johnny Walker Lewis. Six-year-old's like, whoa, sorry, Dad. Ridiculous. What? I don't have kids. I'm actually glad about that. But in all my experience of watching people feed kids, one more bite. I've never seen a situation where a six-year-old ate so much the rest of the family went hungry. So first, we're not talking about a kid here. Fundamental difference in culture. In our world, our children, when they become adults, they marry and they leave. Average age of marriage now is 30 years and 9 months. All right? So normally now they leave before they marry. But sometimes they marry and then they leave because they've made a choice of who they're going to be with. Is that how life worked back then? No. Was there choice in marriage? No. This is how marriage worked. You had your period. 3 weeks after that, they had chosen a guy that you were going to marry. And that is it. And when you married that guy, where did you live? In your family's home. They would build another room. I've been to Israel. I've seen how this works. What they would do, it was a very long, narrow, about the size of this, long, narrow stone structures, and when a new, young, teenage couple was coming in, they would get the back room, and the older people were in the front room, and then as people died off, you sort of graduated. The idea was, the closer you get to the front of the house, the closer you are to the door. Like, that was the idea, right? Oh, God, we just moved into the front room. Well, Betty, I guess our time is just about up. Now, keep in mind, the average age of death back then was 32 years old. Average age of death in Jesus' day was 32, right? So till death do us part is something totally different than today. Till death do us part back then was, you know, put up with a crap for about 10 years, you'll die. Today, when you make a choice, you got to live with it till 84 or whatever. So it's just a nightmare. Anyway, so... Somebody asked me, Shane, why is the divorce rate going up? Why? Well, because we're living longer, that's why. So, there's a fundamental difference between the word son and the word child. You could be a son and be 26 years old, but you live in these family compounds. What Moses is saying is that And you got to picture this. There might be 30 people in this family compound, and you can't have one eating all the food. And you can't have one causing havoc on the peace in the home by drinking too much. Essentially, Moses is saying, once you do all you can do to maintain peace in your home, if you've done everything you can do, and you got one son causing havoc on everybody else, you can put him out. Do all you can do, take it to the elders of the city. If you do all you can do, and they do all they can do, then you can have him stoned. It'd be better for everybody. Now, is that barbaric?
Yeah.
Is that a whole lot better than stoning kids?
Yeah.
So, is Moses for stoning adult sons? Yes and no. It might help to know that in Hebrew, there's two meanings to the word stone. Same as today. Is there two meanings to the word stone today?
Yeah.
Like if I said, I got stoned last night. Nobody's thinking that poor guy got hit in the head with a rock. But they're thinking it is. Right? In Hebrew, stoned can mean pick up a rock and hit someone in the head with it. Or it can mean a banishment. It was a euphemism, a metaphor for banishing. What would happen is they would take the rebellious son to the city gates, the men would hold stones and point. And he's going to essentially be saying, you're not going to live like that anymore. Out. You're wreaking havoc. Out. It was a banishment. The Mishnah, a Jewish compilation of civil religious law, says that at no time is Deuteronomy 21 ever to be taken as literal stoning, but always as a banishment. The Mishnah goes on to say, but if at any time the rebellious son wants to come back and live within the family rules and enhance peace, the father must determine his authenticity and welcome him back with a meal. And the kingdom of God is like a stubborn, rebellious, prodigal son who went away and squandered his entire inheritance. But when he came back, the father ran out and met him and put on the robe and welcomed him back into the family by cooking him a meal. This is the Bible. It's beautiful. There's all kinds of examples of this theory. Like, there's millions of them, it feels like. Like, let me just show you a couple of them. Like, there's Deuteronomy 21, you know, which is what we just read about killing kids and shaving girls. Then there's, of course, there's this weird passage about an unknown God, you know, like, so Paul shows up in Athens and he goes, hey, I see amongst all your gods, there's one God that's called the unknown God. Let's just call him Jesus and be done with it. I mean, is Paul allowed to do that? Is that a missionary, evangelistic sort of strategy that we would enhance today? Then, of course, you have this awful story in John chapter 5 about this pool called Bethesda, where evidently an angel would stir the water of this pool, and only the first person in would get healed, and everybody else wouldn't. So, like, God's in heaven. He's like, I'm bored. I want some entertainment. Hey, angel, go stir that water down there. What we're going to do is we're going to heal the first one in, and no one else is going to heal. And we'll successfully create a race amongst afflicted people. This is going to be awesome. Because nothing gets my God heart beating like a bunch of crippled people trying to move fast. This is going to be awesome. Do you understand the story underneath? There's a history behind that. Woo. Then there's dirty sponges. Like, why are they trying to kill Jesus all day? And then right at the end, you're like, you know, I'm thirsty. And they're like, well, get another drink. That makes no sense. Then there's whitewashed tombs. The world, what's the gates of hell? The heck's going on there? Why is that an actual place? What about stones crying out? That's weird. What's going on there? Well, in the world was Jesus right in the dirt. Why would you ever chop off a man's ear? That's odd. And why wasn't Peter arrested for chopping off a man's ear? A crazy lunatic act, hacking a man's ear off in front of witnesses, and the Roman soldiers were like, oh, these crazy dudes. Was it legal to hack off a man's ear in Jerusalem? My goodness. He got away with it. And what about the dead bury the dead? How insensitive can you be? Hey, Jesus, I want to follow you. Sure, come follow me. I need to bury my dad first. Oh, forget that. Just let the dead bury the dead. How awful. What about sounding trumpets? And why in the world did the blind man start stripping? That's odd. Have you ever met somebody just a little too excited to meet you? And why 30 pieces of silver? Why not a big bag of silver?
Why not a small bag of silver?
Why 30 pieces? What about Coleman's baseballs? Why does it say that the clothes were piled down and the face cloth was folded neatly to the side? What in the world is going on there? And what about Ananias and Sapphira? What an odd story. People just fallen dead. Odd. And what about the blessed sight-like woman? Why is that such a big deal? What about the creation account and how it's a retelling of the Enuma Elish's version of how Barton created it, exalting the God of Israel, Elohim, over the Babylonian high God Barton? What about that? And why do the Gospels tell contradictory stories? What's going on there? Like Matthew said, Jesus cursed the fig tree, and then after that walked into the temple and turned over the tables. Mark says he turned over the tables, and after that walked outside and cursed the fig tree. I mean, if God wrote it, he got confused. What's happening today? And why do the book of Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles differ so much from speaking the same event? I wonder why that is. And why do we contradict your command when God not just make up his mind? Why would God tell us to turn the other cheek? Does that actually work? What's going on there? And what about go the extra mile? And when Jesus said the word heaven, what were they hearing? And when Jesus said the word hell, what were they hearing? By the way, if someone asks me if I believe in hell, the answer is yes. If someone asks me what is it like, I ask them which one. There's three hells in the New Testament. The problem is it only gets translated one English way, hell. There's three separate hells. Tartar, Gehenna, and Hades. What about rubbish dumps? What about white robes and gold crowns? What a weird way. So John describes heaven as we're wearing white robes and gold crowns. How boring does that sound? That sounds horrendous, actually. Maybe he's referencing something else about Domitian and the Roman Empire. What about rending the garments? What about casting aside garments? What about binding and loosing? What's he talking about there? What about letting the dead bury the dead? That's so awful, I wrote that in there twice. What about good eyes and bad eyes? What about yokes? What about shaking the dust off your feet? How can a guy who says always bless your enemies in the same words say shake the dust off your feet? What's going on there? What about clean and unclean? What about tassels on garments? And probably most importantly, the most important question of the morning is, well, what in the world did Moses see when he saw God's backside? Because it says that God hid Moses in the rock with his hand. Well, how big is God's hand? It's pretty big. But if God's hand is big, God's butt would be enormous. And he showed it to Moses. What in the world is going on here? There's all these things. The Bible is beautiful and awe-inspiring and life-giving and progressive and earth-shaking and politics destroying and kingdom building. It is all these things, but it is also ugly and complicated and is anything but simple. For us to have a good relationship with our community, we have to watch the way we communicate Scripture. Because if we communicate Scripture static, you will come across as serving an ugly God. If you remove the risen Christ from the climax of the story, it's ugly. But when you see everything in there as a dynamic, progressive move in the right direction until the culmination of the ages, the climax of the story, the final word of God, the risen Christ, that is moving. I've got like 17 of them in there, but there's only 7 minutes left. There's not enough time to do it well. We'll come back tonight. I'm going to do something very specific. You've got it. I promise you, it will not be a waste of your time to come back tonight and change your life. Since we do have 7 minutes left, I will carefully and with trepidation open it up to questions. Now, listen, let me define that. First, a question has to end in a question mark. It's not a question. It's a theological statement, and no one cares. That's one. Two, it needs to be stated quickly. Three, it needs to be mutually edifying. Okay? So in other words, I care about your cousin Dave, but this is not the time to ask Dave about your specific cousin Dave. This needs to be questions that you might think the whole room might be wondering. Okay? And it needs to be non-antagonistic. If you're into arguing, I am not. We will go fix world hunger and then come back and argue. Okay? So not going to argue. If Jesus is the Christ, he was crucified, the resurrection is true, you're my brother, you're my sister, we're not going to argue. But if you're here, then maybe we can grow together. So anybody willing to give it a shot? Yes, ma'am. Loud enough for everybody here, please.
How do you study to learn all of those historical examples that you put up there so that you can make an answer, that you can be accountable and make an answer when a question arises for you?
That is a great question. Now that's what I'm talking about right there. First, you have to train yourself to ask the right question. We got to get out of the mindset that God wrote it, and more to the mindset that, okay, no, Colette wrote that part, and Moses wrote that part, and whoever wrote Jonah wrote that part, and Micah wrote that part, and Matthew wrote that part, and Paul wrote this part. And so we have to get out of the mindset that God wrote it, but that God breathed on it. Those are two different things. That's one. And you can train yourself for that. So one of the questions you have to ask all the time is what is this revealing about what they thought God was? Otherwise, we should still be killing animals and stoning adulterers. Okay, so it's that. Second, and you're going to hear me say this again in another service, but you can hear this twice. We have to train ourselves also to, let me say this way. We don't want to be a group of people who are right about Scripture. We want to be a group of people who do something far more dynamic than that, and that is fulfill Scripture. Like, it's one thing to be right about Scripture. It's a whole other thing to fulfill Scripture. Now, how do you fulfill Scripture? Jesus said it this way, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, and in so doing, you fulfill Scripture. All right? And that was Jesus' big challenge to the Pharisees who were addicted to being right about Scripture. His challenge to the Pharisees was, don't just be right about Scripture, that sort of can make you mean, fulfill Scripture. So, when they bring him a lady caught in the act of adultery, to be right about Scripture would be to stone her. But Jesus challenged them to do something beyond that, which is fulfill Scripture, which is simply, how would I want to be treated if I were you? And if we treat people how we would want to be treated, we were them, Jesus says that we are now fulfilling Scripture. The church will be on much better footing if instead of being right about Scripture, we become a group of people who desire to fulfill Scripture instead of simply being right about it. Okay? So those are two big thoughts. Now, there's some underpinnings to that, some specifics. So that's the abstract. Here is the concrete. Let me give you a recommended reading list. Okay? So these are books. This is going to make me an absolute nerd. But I've read all these books, it's ridiculous. But here is a recommended reading list. Now, before I give you this, let me be clear. I live with the conviction that I do not have to agree with somebody before I read the book. If all you read is people you agree with, God bless you, but I don't give up, okay? A lot of these people, I cannot swallow everything they say, but I do like chewing, and they all have enhanced my love for Jesus, and they've enhanced my love for Scripture, and they've made things come alive, okay? So, even though I can't swallow everything they say, I can chew on them, all right? And a lot of them are just really good historians. So, Sitting at the Feet of Rabbi Jesus, Covered in the Dust of Rabbi Jesus by Lois Berber. Very, very, very easy to read, very good writer, entertaining, sort of, if you don't ever read another history book in your life, read these two books, The Desire of the Everlasting Hills and The Gifts of the Jews. You can read them in backwards order to that by Thomas Cahill. Thomas Cahill is an award-winning historian who wrote the 7-volume work, The Hinges of History. Essentially, in his opinion, the 7 most important things that have ever happened that put us where we are now. Volume 2 is called The Gifts of the Jews. And essentially, where he makes the case that Abraham and Moses were the most revolutionary figures in the history of the world, primarily because they moved the world from child sacrifice to animal sacrifice, and that was a massive move in the right direction. And he also makes the case that they gave us the gift of surprise and hope, and he talks about the way their Egyptian and Persian culture thought. It's a very helpful book. The Design of the Everlasting Hills is his biography of Jesus Christ. So it's a weird way to say it, but that's a historical look at Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount, Everything Belongs, and The Naked Now by Richard Rohr. R-O-H-R. Richard Rohr is ridiculous. He lives in New Mexico. He is a Franciscan monk that I think has done nothing but sit around and know God. Amazing. Now, I tried to hear him speak one time, and it was like, okay. But his writing is unbelievable. You read Richard Rohr, it's like, Richard Rohr is like what would happen if Shakespeare and the Hulk had a kid. It is unbelievable. Some good history there. Where Was God Born and Walking the Bible by Bruce Feeler. The JPS Tour Commentary and the Bible as It Was by James Kugel. If you want a good grasp of Genesis, there's Genesis by Nathan Sarna. Let me add to that, it's not on the slide. Nathan Sarna can be a little bit hard to read. One of the best books on Genesis I've ever read in my life is Genesis for Normal People by Peter Enns. Peter Enns is a fully devoted follower of Jesus. He is a professor of theology at Eastern Seminary in St. David's, Pennsylvania. He is also the head scholar and theologian for Biologos. Him and N.T. Wright move on together. He is, in short, one of the smartest people on planet Earth. He has a PhD in ancient Near Eastern literature from Harvard. Unbelievable. And yet he writes at about a 10th grade level. So really, really easy to read. The best book I've read in 4 years was The Bible Tells Me So by Peter Enns. Peter Enns is saving the Bible for the Google generation. Now let me be clear, I'm not a Peter Enns apologist. I do not and cannot swallow everything he says. But I can tell you this, when I finish the book, I love Jesus more and I love the Bible more. Right? He says some things in there that I was like, ooh, whatever. Okay? The Bible Tells Me So by Peter Enns, Inspiration and Incarnation by Peter Enns. One of the best books on Genesis, well, the best book on Genesis I've ever read in my life was Genesis for Normal People by Peter Enns, E-N-N-S. Great guy. The Myth of the Christian Nation and The Myth of the Christian Religion by Greg Boyd. Understanding the Difficult Words of Jesus by David Bibbin. Poet and Peasant by Kenneth Bailey. Our Father Abraham by Marvin Wilson. Read that last. That is not toilet reading. That is, you got to shut the TV off and close the door and concentrate. The Liberation of Christmas by Richard Horsley. Unapologetic by Francis Spoofer. Anything Ever Written by N.T. Wright. It's not the name of the book, by the way. It's Anything He Ever Writes. Be careful with N.T. Wright, though, because N.T. Wright has a scholar collection, and then he has like a normal person collection. Make sure it's the normal person collection. Normally, the normal person collection, the author is Tom Wright. That's his name. The N is, I don't know what the N is, but Tom Wright is his name. Same guy, N.T. Wright. Interesting review, actually, by Brad Young, Jesus the Jewish Theologian, Paul the Jewish Theologian, Parables, and Meet the Rabbi. That'll get you going. When you're done, when you're done, call me. That takes us past noon. Great question. I'm actually glad you asked that. That was flipping fantastic. That's an example. Following example of what a question should be.
You can pay me later.
That's like the ultimate softball. I love spending 2 hours with you. I hope you love spending 2 hours with me. I hope it didn't feel like 2 hours. I know it's noon because my stomach's starting to growl. I got up at 3 and ate breakfast at 4. So the stomach's going, might be time to eat. So my stomach's doing that. If you get hungry, you'll turn on me like a bunch of magic. So, on your way out, if you'd like to get something at the table, I just ask that you would do it expeditiously. If you would, if you want to chat, amen. But if you could buy, and then chat. That would be awesome. Now, if you don't want anything, God bless you. Don't worry. But you know you need it. Come by. Come in, feed some kids. And then go chat and have coffee with your friends. Talk about what we talked about. I hope today Jesus got bigger, the cross worked better, the resurrection central. I hope Jesus is more beautiful today than when he walked in. I hope the scriptures are more beautiful today than when he walked in. I hope that we'll never quit growing and changing and moving and questioning and engaging God. I've enjoyed it. You've laughed when you're supposed to laugh, cry when you're supposed to cry, you were shocked when you were supposed to be shocked, and all of that is relieving to a communicator soul. So look forward to seeing you in 96. Trust me, you won't regret it.